So thank you for coming. We're really excited to be here. We are gonna be talking about data tools for housing justice. So using data and technology in different ways to try to prevent displacement. Obviously there's a lot of real estate development going on in the city and a lot of residential real estate development, whether it's related to the mayor's affordable housing plan or not. So with that development often comes increased displacement pressure in neighborhoods, often in low-income communities of color. So that's a problem that people are trying to respond to, and part of responding to that involves access to information and public data that the city provides, and in some ways trying to get a hold of the tools and data that real estate developers use for speculation and to gain profit by displacing people. So those are the kinds of projects we're working on. We're gonna be talking about three different projects, starting with the Cypress Hills Early Warning System, and then Barika's gonna talk about the Association for Neighborhood Housing and Development's Dap.Map project, and then Dan and George are gonna be talking about the JustFix project. So with that, I'm going to hand it over to Dubois to talk about the project and the need for this kind of thing.
Thank you, Lucy. So as a tenant organizer, we are constantly faced with the obstacles of where to best use our limited resources. For much of my time at Cypress Hills, I was the only tenant organizer, so I had to be able to choose where I did my work carefully. Then, when in 2014-15, when it was announced that East New York would be rezoned, the need for kind of hyper-speed information was made very clear to me because things started to change very rapidly. Decades past, East New York was mostly a kind of neglected corner of the city. Now, with the rezone, there is incentive for development to happen and therefore incentive for displacement. And so we wanted to create a tool that would focus our attention and our resources better. And so working with Lucy, kind of coming up with what are the indicators of harassment, what are the indicators of displacement, and how early on in that process can we get to give our organizers a head start on what's going on. Focusing a lot on conditions and bank records to kind of figure out what, if a property is in a situation where it might be over leveraged or not, but also a way that our organizers, when they see something on the ground, a way that that could augment the information. So in situations where we see the amount of units in the apartment does not actually line up with what is registered there, right? So if we're relying solely on the city data, solely on data that in many instances is actually reported by the landlords themselves, so at the inception of that data, it could be compromised, right? It could be inaccurate. So we wanted a way to be able to kind of flesh out all those different factors so that we could prioritize where our work was, but then also come back and use that data to do further research when we figured out whatever that particular campaign for that building would be, and be able to identify links with other properties so as to kind of just maximize our resources across the board.
Cool, okay. So I'm gonna be showing a prototype of the tool that we've been working on. And we have a version that's happened already. It didn't have a mechanism to be updated automatically, so the second version is doing that. So what I'm gonna show you is the prototype of what this tool looks like. So I have to like crouch down to do this, but. Yeah, maybe I'll put it up on here. Okay, so this is the database side of the tool, bringing together a lot of publicly available data. A lot of it's from open data from the city, from different agencies. Some of it's not. So this is meant to give the organizer this high-level overview of certain indicators. It's not necessarily scientific what particular threshold indicates that there's a problem in the building, and that's something that we're actually kind of going to play around with a little bit over time. But this is meant to provide like a lot of information about a lot of properties at once. And then when the organizer identifies a property that they want to know more about, so for example, we're going to look at this one. They can take the BBL, which is the property identifier, nodding their heads because they use BBLs a lot. They're going to take the BBL and they're going to put it into this page and get more detailed information about what's going on in the building. So again, this is meant to bring together a lot of sources of information that are available with some digging, so that somebody can kind of look at everything at once. So in here we've got information about how many stabilized units are registered in a building, which can be hard to get a hold of, and the city doesn't make public in a way that you can download it directly in a spreadsheet form. This has got information about the property itself, zoning information. For example, in East New York, where there's been a big zoning change, we want to know if a property might have a big potential increase in developable square footage. So this would calculate that. We've got an aggregation of recent complaints, violations, and jobs filed with the Department of Buildings, including a link to be able to go directly to the Department of Buildings page and look up more information. Also, recent mortgages or deeds filed with the Department of Finance. And then a bit more granular information about complaints and violations from HPD. So like the agent, it's pretty uneven how much information you can get in what way from different agencies. And HPD is one where you have to individually like load up a property. It can be a little bit slow, whereas DOB, you can go directly to it through a link. So within the system, we would have a list where somebody can see what the recent complaints filed are with detailed information about like what that complaint is and what the violations are. There's one more component of the map of the project, which is a map. And so this is, it's a bit of like an old version, but it's meant to show how the map functions. So this is through Cardo. And when you zoom in, you have, again, kind of like an unscientific indicator of indicators of how many different things. So if we designate these flags, like there's been a recent increase in violations or a recent property document, like deed or mortgage filed, that could be something that adds like to the color gradient of the properties. There are 906 properties that we're interested in this geography. This is like a custom geography that the organizers are interested in. And those are the properties that most likely have rent stabilized units in them. So you can hover over it, you can get some initial information and then click on it and get more of that information that's also included in the database part of it. And it's ready to go. I think it's loading. I don't know how to do it. I'll go over and ask the card people why that's happening.
There you go.
So there you get some more of that information. If anybody wants to take a look at more detail later, show you. It's not finished. Okay, I'm gonna pass it over to
Brika. Alright. So, hi everyone. So you'll see how these all start to connect pretty quickly. So my name again, Brika Williams. If there's folks in the back who want to take the other seat or feel free. I work at ANHD, the Association for Neighborhood and Housing Development. We work with 100 groups across the city, like Cypress Hills, that all work in specific neighborhoods. They're all neighborhood-based nonprofits. So we really think at the citywide perspective, right? Our role is to sort of say, like, what's happening across the city? How can we help specific neighborhoods in their areas? And then how can we think about, like, what's being connected? So I'm going to pass these two things around. I don't have enough of all of them for everyone, but there's the purple ones are housing and the white ones are economic development. And you can just do half for one, half the room, and half for the other. If you don't mind just taking only one. So you'll see, we start, ANHD has done one of these, which refers to different things. Heat map, housing risk chart, it's got a bunch of different names. And basically every year we go through and we do 20 indicators of data for housing and economic development by community district, PUMAs generally speaking, right? We've done this now for about 10 years, and what has always happened is people are like, I want more information, I want to know specific stuff. Well, PUMAs are too big, community districts are too big, there's multiple neighborhoods in them, and so gradually over time we sort of got to like, how can we tell Cypress Hills what they need for their area, as opposed to just like an entire community district? And thus was born over here. The Dap.Map. So we started this project called the Dap.Map, the Displacement Alert Project. What we are looking at is sort of pulling together mostly public data, a little bit of a star there, that is available across all five boroughs data is building level indicators to be able to keep track of displacement. So what we have in here is loss of rent regulated units, DOB permits, so then how much construction, rehab, renovations are happening, and the property sales level. How much are buildings selling for more than what was considered normal 5 years or so ago in a neighborhood. And then we look at geographies. You can add community districts, council districts, zip codes, and you can search for a specific address. So generally, this is DOB, DOF data. There's a little bit of some stuff that we have to put some things together, or we like find a way to customize it, because the way that they make it accessible isn't always actually the way that we need to use it, that organizers need to use it. It's kind of a continual challenge for us in housing data, is the way that it's made available isn't always the way that people actually need to be able to like get information from it. And so this is sort of zoomed in what you get and what it looks like for a given district. I'm going to go back to this guy. Let's get started. Let's run there. I don't know how to zoom other way. Yeah. So, for example, this. Everyone see this? Is loss of rent regulated units. This is, where are we? We're Upper East Side. So this is 76th Street. This is the East River, right? So you get an idea. Obviously, like red is highest alert and yellow is lowest alert. And we sort of graduate everything by their different layers. And then you can turn on council districts. You can turn on community boards, et cetera, right? So you can sort of see the geographies. And then for any given building, you can find out the specific information. So in this building, there are 384 residential units. It was built in 1910. It has lost 15 rent-regulated units since 2007, which is 100% of the rent-regulated units that were in the building since 2007. So it's lost all 15 of them in the past 7 years that it had to begin with. But then the two boxes also tell you there have been DOP permits, and it also has had a property sale in the past few years. So it's sort of a way to get organizers, groups on the ground, elected officials, legal service providers, some information that they need on the individual building and project. So one thing to flag is that buildings in here have to have one of those three indicators. We start with about 800,000 properties across the city. And so you only end up in our data set if you have been sold in the last year, which will be expanding, if you have had rent-regulated units at any point in time since 2007, or if you have had a DOB permit pulled. If you have not had any activity on your building since 2007, we don't have you in our database. Does that make sense? There are residential buildings that we don't look at because they've sort of been static over the past 7 or so years. As we sort of expand the data out, we'll end up with more and more and more units and more buildings. All right. Let's see. So what are some of the findings? There's about 100,000 actual units in the data set. There are about 45,000 units that had at least one rent-regulated unit since 2007. 25,000, so about a quarter of the data, has at least one high-risk floor in one of the three categories. The New York City has lost about 156,000 rent-regulated units since just 2007. So it's an enormous loss of our affordable housing stock. We've demolished about 3,500 buildings. And over 5,400 buildings, sales price has more than doubled what the neighborhood average was just 5 years before. So that's like my building sold for $20 million in 2011, and in 2015 it had sold for 44, right? That kind of jump, which for us is also a sign of, it's not guaranteed speculation, but more than likely the rents that are in that building now will not cover the cost of the mortgage for the new building, and so likely you'll see evictions and harassment and these types of things. That's most of what we've got. What comes next is we will be trying to update the data quarterly. adding additional data and information, building in some more interactive features so that we can also get reports out. So I would also say a shameless plug, if anybody is looking to work on data projects, we are always looking for people. We always have groups that are looking for data data projects and data resources, and we just can't provide them all. We actually are pretty small, and there's only three of us in our office that do data, so we're always happy to help make that connection. This is phase one, and so we'll be starting to work on phase two and three and all the way up to six and seven probably over the next year or so. So thanks.
Okay, so hi guys. Again, my name is Dan. So I work for JustFix.nyc. So we're a nonprofit. Again, we work with tenants directly to help build well-documented legal cases for many of the same issues that Breka and Dubois were talking about. So folks that are predominantly living in a rent-regulated housing situation where there's currently a lot of incentive on the part of their landlord to not provide services, to be actively in a state of harassment, or just be generally neglectful, or be an absentee landlord. So the sort of challenge that we've taken on is looking at all the data that we've been talking about today from the various citywide agencies, data that we're pulling from our own, and really bringing that into your average New Yorker's perspective. The product that we have, and again, this is for tenants, it's tenant facing, has been sort of the result of about a year and a half's worth of outreach and usability testing. We've just finished a beta round of about 500 cases, where actual sort of cases that are going through either to negotiate with the landlord or to actually go to court. The sort of favorite story that I like to tell up front is, we were looking at all this data. The basic example is the open violations you might have on your home. We would, print it out, from HBD. You show it to someone who, we're working with, and we say, well, so here's the open violations. And they're like, great, my building has problems with it. Like, tell me something I didn't know already. Approach that we're taking here is really to look at all of this data that's available to you as a an average tenant and make it into something that is action oriented. So knowing what we know about your building or your landlord, what are some steps you can take, and what's going to make the most sense for your situation as well. So it's pretty simple. It's going to look pretty simple, and that's pretty intentional. Someone would go to JustFix.nyc. This is a web app. It's available in English and Spanish. It's accessible. So by meaning web app, you can get it from a public computer at a library, desktop computer, if you have a tablet, or a smartphone. We also partner with a lot of community organizing groups who are actually doing this on behalf of folks that wouldn't be able to do it themselves as well. So you're going to go in. You're going to, you're getting started here. You're going to do a room by room inspection of all of the sort of issues that you want to report as you're currently experiencing. And this is very much not a one-to-one matchup to what HPD might look like for code violations. This is supposed to be, so we adapted this from a physical checklist that our partner organizations use. And it's, when you're thinking, oh, there's like a leak, you're not knowing the admin code of the violation that you need to tell HPD, right? You just know, that the ceiling is falling. It's pretty basic. So we want to give people, a more plain language way to sort of report what exactly they're experiencing on a room-by-room basis.
Very sorry.
We'll also be able to do, we have a lot of, group cases with tenant associations, so there's a lot about public areas. Shared issues are a huge thing. If there's bed bugs in one apartment, it's pretty likely they're going to be in another one, as well as harassment type of issues as well. This is another category where the legal definition of harassment doesn't really match up one-to-one with what people are actually experiencing a lot of the time. So we want to give them a pretty open opportunity to report everything they might be dealing with and not things that might just fit into the more rigid definitions of how the city or state or the legal system might view it. So we'll go through. You can easily add, you know, custom ones. So I'll add a few about my bedroom and public areas. So you'll go here. You know, we ask for the bare minimum of information, but you know what's really important to note, obviously, is the address. So when they put in the address, we're actually behind the scenes, cross-referencing not only the issues they've been reporting, we'll make that translation from the actual plain language issue into what a likely sort of what it would be defined by HPD or DOB, as well as any other sort of data that we'll know about the building or the landlord that we've been able to determine. And what we'll actually show, and I'll have it here, is that's all just feeding into an algorithm that's recommending steps to take. So you'll go here, you'll say, great, take action. And now this list is curated to you know, the type of issues you might be dealing with. So if we know that the heating violation you've reported, it's the first time that it's being reported for the building, we're gonna recommend things differently than if that building has had years and years of heating type of violations. So we'll try to escalate the situation. If, you know, for example, to a lot of the data that Dap.Map or Cypress Hills use, you know, to be able to say this building has rent regulated units. If your building has rent regulated units, we'll actually be able to show you a card for requesting your rental history from DHCR. And then for each one of these steps, we're also really interested in simplifying them too. So, you know, a lot of this can be fairly bureaucratic, as I'm sure you wouldn't be surprised. So we make it, you know, previously you had to call that in to a hotline or send a letter and make it as easy as sort of a tap of a button. We'll also, you know, filter out for special programs or things that might exist, you know, solely in your area. So the address that I entered in is in one of these, identified areas of rezoning. And so the city has a lot of, anti-harassment or rezoning protections for folks that are living in specific zip codes. And so we'll be able to just determine that automatically and you know, again, show new cards. As you complete certain actions, you know, new ones will appear over time. So there's nothing here when you get started on, you know, going forward with a legal case. We want you to do precursors like sending formal notices, trying to get inspections, and escalating the process as you go along. And of course, you see that button that says I've tried this, so you can just skip steps as you've already done stuff. We want it to just make the most sense for where you're at and what you want to do. I think another really important thing to note here that we've gotten from usability testing has been the reason why there are several options, you know, there are several types of actions that someone can take. We want it to be somewhat guided, but also somewhat open, in that, you know, some folks don't want to call 301 because they think 301 is going to notify their landlord and there's going to be retaliation, or, you know, other types of actions. So we want to give them a sense that there's things that they can do, but we're not making them do anything they don't want to do either. And then, so the final step here is we make it super easy for them to get connected with community groups and legal services that are going to be in their area that they're probably going to be eligible for. And so this map is, we have this as a standalone service that a lot of citywide hotlines use to make targeted referrals. That's terrifying. So for a tenant using this, they'll be able to quickly get connected with not only who's going there might be eligible for, but this is again something that's directly from usability testing. A lot of folks will just want to go to the place that's literally the closest to them. So we'll just sort that by proximity. You can see easily that CASA, one of our partners, is less than half a mile away. You can easily get walking or subway directions to go in person and see that. And then finally, the last thing we'll talk about is how we do outreach. So this is in use by hundreds of tenants. We have about 10 organizations that use sort of the back end of this, which is a dashboard that helps organizations keep track of all these tenants and that they're directly responsible for. And so we also use a lot of this data to know where to do outreach. So I think one of the great things about 301 data is you're getting that in on a daily basis. And a lot of folks who are in pretty severe situations are calling 301 pretty repeatedly. So, you know, we can use this as a tool for proactive outreach, and we've done that with some of our partners in Brooklyn, is, you know, actually going through, I think I have it over here. You know, again, in a pretty basic sense, but even this is super helpful in saying, you know, just in the past couple weeks, these, you know, red indicators are places that have had repeated housing complaints from 311. And we'll be able to, you know, if we're doing door-to-door or, you know, we're doing firing, we'll know the particular hotspots in any sort of neighborhood that we're going to or that our partners are sort of, you know, distributing in. So cool, that's about us.
Yeah, so I think we'll open it up for Q&A in a second, but just wanted to start with a couple prepared questions. So the first question is the Cypress Hills group. So how are you thinking about sort of maintaining, sustaining, and continuing to improve on the work that you guys have done thus far?
Right, yeah, so that's one thing that I've been working with Cypress Hills on. If you think back to that dashboard and lookup tool that Lucy showed you, it's all really targeted information for the tenant organizers there, but it's not sustainable to update it manually every month. It's a very time-intensive and labor-intensive process. And so I've been working with Lucy to create a backend that will automatically update on a monthly basis that dashboard and lookup tool. And I've been implementing that through doing a one-command Python script that is retrieving data from over 10 open data portals, APIs, and then using Pandas data frames to scrape a lot of it, to transform it and standardize it, because there are a lot of different formats that these different agencies use, and then be able to index and order it by BBL, that unique identifier, to export into something that's usable for this front-end interface. And so the biggest priorities for that back-end implementation is to make it really simple to use for the housing organizers, to make it as low maintenance as possible, so to have really rigorous error checking and ability to catch when the city changes the way it does data, and also to make it low-tech enough to run on the Mac computers that Cypress Hills has without a lot of infrastructure. And so that's sort of our plan for moving forward, being able to have this tool that draws on all this great data but makes it specific and usable by tenant organizers at Cypress Hills.
And another question for any or all of you. What types of like public policy proposals do you have that would make your lives easier or would make a significant difference you feel in solving or at least you know, curbing a lot of the displacement that's happening in the neighborhoods that you're working in?
One of the things that ANHD with most of our groups is working on is this thing called the Certificate of No Harassment, CONH campaign. And it's actually been in place in two specific places in New York City. And what we're trying to get is make it citywide. And that would be to say, with data analysis, looking at a building, sort of looking back, 5 year, 10 year, we're having conversations with city and city council to figure out like what exactly the mechanism is. You would look back and say, has this building had a demonstrated history of harassment? Yes or no? And if so, they go through one process, and if not, they go ahead and they get their building permit. But if you do have a concern of harassment or a demonstrated proven history of harassment, then you go through an extra a set of scrutiny and an extra process, and cannot get your building permit for like major rehab or new construction or demolition until that issue is resolved, right? In a sense, what we're trying to remove is rewarding landlords for harassing their tenants, because that is a big mechanism for how displacement happens. Is like, some of the most extreme stories are shocking, but people who leave their house in the morning to go to work or to go somewhere, and their landlord says, hey, I need to do some work on your bathroom, and they come back home and their entire bathroom and kitchen have been demoed, which now makes their building impassable. but then also as a way of like getting rid of the person, kicking them out, and sort of like move, and people systemically doing that through a whole building. So what we're saying is like, we shouldn't just be handing these out when we know that people are using permits as a way to get people out, right?
Yeah, with also that the tool can help us track the behaviors of landlords and then by proxy banks, and so that we could start using this data to hold banks accountable for kind of irresponsible lending to bad actors that do this sort of thing citywide. So it's all work in progress. I could go on all day about policy stuff.
Great. So we have 5 minutes left. So anybody who has a question? Yeah, I think you had your hand up first.
Yeah. This is more for the Cypress Hills and the ANHD group. How do you use your, or are there plans to use your tools for cross organizations, like collaboration or cross organization organizing?
I mean, our tool is open to everybody, or it's open to everybody in the public and our groups, and then our groups have access to a separate set of stuff. So. We are very cautious about making the back end of our data publicly available because we don't want it mined for bad activity. And then we work with these guys all the time to sort of say, like, it's most appropriate for Cypress Hills to do this building. We're also trying to think about how to keep track of a history of, we've been in this building for 5 years and this has happened over time, right? There are sometimes buildings have had four organizers work on them over the history of time, and this is potentially a way to sort of capture that.
Yeah. We don't have any specific plans about, because it is very specific to our neighborhood and our kind of current needs, but there's next steps. Right now.
Yeah, I mean, one of the reasons that we're doing this is that we're interested in possibilities of it being helpful in other neighborhoods. We haven't been designing it or planning it that way right now. Like, the aim is really to make it useful in this very specific way, but I think we all hope that it could be used in other places.
Yeah. This is a question for anybody. One of the problems with tracking landlord behavior is they use LLCs and shell companies to conceal the ownership. Does anybody have any insights into that? Is there any central database that a public interest group is? Nobody's doing that.
I mean, there's one. I know of one that has tried to. Has tried to like combine it and find the person behind LLCs. It's very imperfect. It's very, very difficult to do. It's a huge problem for all of us. It's one of the reasons, actually, there's lots of data that you can't use. Like, housing court data is by the LLC. It's not by the building, and it's not by the individual. So actually, it's kind of hard to use housing court data for anything because you're actually just, the lawsuit is against the like shell, right? Not against the person and not against the building.
Yeah, the sort of most like popular approach, I think that's what Marika is mentioning, is using the registered business addresses of the LLCs. The theory is that the landlords are lazy enough that they'll register a bunch of LLCs at the same place and trying to use that. But again, it's a very imperfect scheme. You know, there's any ways that they could, you know, if they simply just register different LLCs at different places, then it's kind of complex. But it does, that sort of like at least gets you somewhere onto a fuzzy stand, but it is an ongoing, really difficult data problem.
Just for example, there was an article that came out, I think the Gothamists did it, and they linked like 300 LLCs to 199 Lee Avenue, which is basically a storefront of mailboxes. So you can start your search and your bloodhound down the trail, but you'll eventually hit some sort of wall.
Yeah, so just one more question right here.
So there's sort of an arms race between nonprofits and for-profits to try and get data in order to influence the way that real estate works in the city. Where have you found ways where you're competing or collaborating with for-profit interest, whether it be on an individual building scale or on a larger scale, like investing in real estate bonds, how does that relationship work between you guys and for-profits in order to try to encourage responsible investment? I think a lot of interest is in just changing the way that investment works to make it actually have a social benefit.
So I guess I would say there's almost no collaboration. Like, generally I would say there's zero collaboration. They have a whole bunch of access to data that's got a lot of resources. This is us starting to like build that infrastructure as nonprofits. And generally speaking, what folks are trying to do with the same data is very, very different things. There is another thing, if you're interested, called the Building Indicators Project, BIP, that also looks at like banks and lending and sort of gives a rate and a rank for how good the activity is by building based on like the loan and the mortgage. So that's also been out there for a long time, but very different goals and orientation, so I'd almost say zero.
Okay. That's through UNHP in the Bronx. You actually have to request it.
Great, well thank you guys so much. If you are interested in getting more involved, we need the help. So as Brika mentioned, ANHD is always taking volunteers, you know, especially with some sort of data or technical expertise. We're also putting together sort of a coalition of various groups working on similar types of housing data projects, and also individuals interested in that. So please just come find us afterwards. Thanks so much.
Thank you.